Welcome to another episode of the Story to Screen podcast, the movie review podcast where we review movies, both new and old. I am your host, not Chris, actually Joshua. I've done this a few times on my own now, but I'm actually here today with two very special guests. First of all, my sister, ladies
Hi.
First, Abigail Ling.
Hi!
And the man with some sort of plan, I'm sure, Benjamin Curlee.
Hey, what's up?
Doing all right, guys. Doing all right. Well, anything going on for you guys this week? Anything crazy happen? Anything special?
Well, I decided to do some yard work this weekend. I got insect bites and poison ivy all up and down my arm, but...
Guess what? Our host has poison ivy, too.
Seriously?
Twin. Poison ivy twin.
I guess it's just crazy in bloom right now. So.
Yeah.
So yeah, other than that, her, you're making that new house and everything looking nice, right?
It is, yeah. It's slowly coming together, but it's turning out really nice. It's way better to be in a house than an apartment. No doubts there.
Well, then we'll go ahead and go into weekly segments. I only really have one weekly segment this week, and it's because Chris forgot to talk about it on the Jurassic Park review, and he told me to talk about it. Although I would have talked about it anyway.
What did we miss?
A legend in the acting industry passed away.
Yes.
How old was he again? Am I going to have to Google this?
Yeah, you're going to have to Google it.
Oh, let me Google that for you.
No, you should Yahoo it or Bing it.
No, it does not sound right.
Yeah, it just doesn't.
Yahoo it. Nobody says that.
Yahoo!
I remember okay. Those commercials.
He died at... Google, why don't you tell me immediately? Go to Wikipedia for this.
Speak, Google, speak.
What would Google sound like?
Well, in all the commercials, it's like this. It's
93.
Like this.
93.
Yeah. Wow.
So Christopher Lee had passed away at 93 years old. Obviously, such great movies. More recently, as Lord of the Rings and Star Wars, Attack of the Clone Wars and Revenge of the Sith. And he's done just so many different things in so many different ways. Really an interesting guy with a very interesting life, possibly part of British Secret Service at some point. That's all. He'll have to kill you if you find out. So
yeah.
Seriously,
we may never know.
Very interesting man with a very long life of entertaining people, and we salute his body of work here from Story to Screen. Well, then we will jump right into our review. Hit the trailer, Chris.
So, Riley, how was the first day of school?
Fine, I guess.
Did you guys pick up on that?
Sure did.
Something's wrong.
Signal the husband.
Uh-oh. She's looking at us. What did she say?
Oh, sorry, sir. No one was listening.
Is it garbage night? We left the toilet seat up. What is it, woman? What?
I'm joy. This is sadness. That's anger.
What?
This is disgust. And that's fear. Ah! We're Riley's emotions. These are Riley's memories. They're mostly happy, you'll notice, not to brag.
What you just heard is the trailer for Inside Out, a Pixar animated movie directed by Pete Docter and Ronaldo Del Carmen, starring Amy Poehler, Bill Hader, and Louis Black. So guys, before we jump into that, we had a very interesting short that I feel like definitely needs to be touched on. Since I'm going to let ladies first on the actual review, Ben, what did you think of the short Lava?
I liked it. A lot of my thoughts are going to be tempered a little bit because of this guy who was sitting behind me who just didn't. I don't even know. It's just okay. So he thinks something is funny, and so he tries to laugh, but it's the most forced laugh you've ever heard. No. Okay, let me see if I can mimic it here. Okay, I'm
gonna step away. This is gonna be great.
Something along the lines of that.
Sounds like he's dying.
That's exactly what it sounded like. It's like
excellent performance, Ben. Excellent. Man.
So yeah, would have been better without that.
Good job, Abigail. Good job.
That's exactly it. But no, I loved it. That was really good. It's got a really catchy little tune that I've been humming for the last 2 days. So, I quite enjoyed it.
I'll throw it over to Abigail here, and she has some news about this as well.
I've been playing it for the last few days on ukulele, and I have a tutorial of it on my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/MissHappyNarwhal. I have a tutorial and a cover of it, so I really enjoyed the short. And my dad and I went home, and he's like, let's figure this song out on your ukulele. And we played it together, so that was a lot of fun.
Nice.
Yep.
And what did you think of the short?
It was so cute. I am a sucker for that kind of stuff. It was so sweet. Oh, the little volcano man is my favorite. He's just so squishy looking.
He's not exactly
looking.
Little, but...
Whatever, he was adorable.
I thought it was really interesting, the use of helicopter shots in the short. Everything was done in a way to make you really look at how big these volcanoes were and stuff like that, and it felt very large.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not one that usually notices cinematography, but I thought that was a good choice. And yes, it's an amazing song, and I really felt like the story itself was... we're allowed to spoil on this show.
No, I have...
Oh, you have something to say?
In a minute.
Okay. I felt like it was very Hans Christian Andersen. The loss and gaining and, you know, the great things happen through loss kind of feeling to it. It felt like a Hawaiian Hans Christian Andersen story.
Yeah.
Which I thought was pretty great. But, Sissy?
I was going to say that I actually found out this was a tribute to a ukulele player. I do not remember his last name, but his name is Israel.
Oh, yeah. He played the Somewhere Over the Rainbow, What a Wonderful World.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, this was a tribute to him. And they styled the volcano's facial features after him.
That makes total
sense.
So
it was a tribute to him. And I'm not sure if he passed away or something.
Yes, yes.
Did he? When did he pass away?
A couple years ago. He was very, very overweight.
Oh, I think I remember that.
But yeah, I did not know it was to Iz. I'm very familiar with Iz and his music, so...
Yeah.
But yeah, that was very interesting. Very good short. I really hope it wins some major awards. I was very, very happy.
And it was nice to hear a musical short film. Like,
yeah.
Pixar has never done a musical before.
Yeah.
That I know of. So that was very interesting.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, we'll go ahead and jump into the review of Inside Out. I'm going to open things up. First of all, ladies first, with your thoughts overall on the film Inside Out.
Well, it was really hyped up for me. It's like, oh, this is the next up, or this is a comeback from Cars 2 and Brave and Monsters. And this is Pixar's back, everyone, and it's getting like 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, and I'm really excited. And while I wasn't let down, the pace really threw me off. Like, at one point it's throwing jokes at you 24/7, and it had a very strange pace in the first half, and then I think in the end it kind of resolved itself, but the pacing was kind of strange to me. I don't know what the deal was with that.
Any other thoughts on characters or anything?
Are we going to get to that, or am I doing that now?
You can talk about whatever you want to talk about, point out specifically about the film.
Let's see. I liked... Can I spoil?
Yes.
Okay, so I liked... The thing that was really important was that you can't have joy all the time without sadness, and that's a very good point to make, and I think that's great for a Pixar movie to do something like that, and I know they do stuff like that before, but that was great.
How about you, Benjamin? Overall thoughts?
Overall thoughts? Oh, it was, it's definitely right near the top of the list. I still don't think it beats Up, in my opinion, as far as story, but it was very close. It was an emotional roller coaster, had me crying the last 20 minutes, just all the way through. It was really well thought out and well done. The just to dive into emotions and explore those, the way they interact and play with each other and how they work in, you know, in a different environment and different settings and different contexts. And it was really fascinating to see that. And it was great. I loved it.
All right. I actually, my favorite Pixar movie is The Incredibles. And number two for me would be Up. This one actually fell on, you know, without, yes, it's a pun, but not, I don't mean it to be a pun, on par with The Incredibles.
Mm.
Honest, yeah, there's that laugh again. Very nice. But to me, it is tied for first place for my favorite Pixar movie. I thought it was fantastic. I really did love, in this movie as well as the short, a very Hans Christian Andersen feel, the idea that you need sadness in order to have happiness, that great triumph comes through great trial. And in such a weird way, we have, we represent such a large scale thing to a small child. And so mm-hmm. it's like, in one sense, a very large epic story in the mind of this girl, but also a very small scale story
mm-hmm.
about a little girl.
Yeah.
And I think that contrast was particularly interesting. Generally just the idea of, you know, playing with these emotions and things. It's such a creative idea, and I really do feel like Pixar is going to start doing more movies like these, but also, you know, putting out the cars and things just to keep things afloat. But
just sell the merchandise.
But yeah. I do think that they're not, I think it's very obvious that they want to make more Inside Outs.
Mm-hmm.
But in order to do that, they have to put out more cars. So mm-hmm. that's just life. And that's fine. I don't mind that. So, what did you guys notice a similarity? I definitely did, to a certain other director who's a contemporary of John Lasseter, Don Bluth. This movie felt very Don Bluth to me. As a reminder to anyone listening, that's The Secret of Nim, Land Before Time, Thumbelina, the American Tail movies, stuff like that. This movie felt very much like that. Ben, did you catch any Don Bluthiness here?
No, I really wasn't looking for that. So no, it didn't stand out to me.
How about you, Sissy?
Only when you mentioned it, I wasn't looking.
Well, when I mentioned it, is there anything you noticed? That's...
No, it just felt like a Pixar movie to me. It didn't feel like Don Bluth. It just felt like Up.
Okay. Well, Up felt a little Bluthy to me too, but you know, whatever. Well, moving on from that, I think kind of segueing. I thought one of the big things that reminded me of Don Bluth was the character Bing Bong. Her imaginary friend, made of cotton candy, looks kind of like a cat and an elephant,
yeah.
And apparently a dolphin. this idea of his almost like a fairy godmother, in a way, helping out Joy and Sadness, figuring out where they need to go, and just, you know, it felt Toy Story-ish too, you know, letting go of certain things, and
mm-hmm.
him, you know, having passed away. That scene in particular reminded me of other, you know, sacrificial situations in Don Bluth movies, where characters realize that they have to go in order to, you know, finish the mission.
Mm-hmm.
And what did you guys think of Bing Bong?
Well, I mean, he was pretty annoying at first.
Yes.
But he really grew on me, and it was reminding me of, okay, you know, sounds vaguely like some of the imaginary friends that I had growing up. I mean, they weren't so imaginative in I didn't really go into that depth imagining them, you know, how they would look, but you know, the adventures, it's like, yeah, I did that, you know, similar stuff. And
you had a song powered wagon?
No, nothing that extreme, but
you were
but
not,
you know,
living.
But no, by the time it got to his demise, I really liked the character, and that was what set off the tears for me, was the end of him, and they just continued through the rest of the movie. But no, that was an excellent performance, and it was really good.
Abigail?
The whole time when he was on there, I kept thinking, who voiced him? Like, I knew his voice, and like one of my brothers told me it was the guy who played Molt from A Bug's Life.
Yep.
So I don't know who else he played, but I was going to say it wasn't so important to me that the character himself died, but that Riley's imaginary friend died. Because she grew up and she grew out of him and she had no place for him.
Yeah, that is the sad part. Yeah.
That's what hit me the most. I was like, well, she's growing up. And then, like, all the stuff being replaced in her imagination land, like, with the boyfriend maker or something like that. They're like, when was this put here? This is dumb. And I was like, I feel you there, movie. I feel you there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, speaking of Bing Bong passing away, how about the body count in this movie? Obviously, we don't know how many boyfriends died for Riley.
Yeah, exactly.
But not only them and Bing Bong, we also had the two cloud people. Just like,
oh yeah, just poof.
Just
yeah.
Poof, dark. That was some legitimately wonderful dark humor that sailed right over the kids' heads.
It's Cloud City, my friend.
And then the cop, yes, at the end, he's like, we can't do anything about this, man. This is Cloud City, or whatever he said. Cloud
so
Town.
Good.
Cloud Town. Oh, that's just, oh, that is some exquisite dark humor
that
right there.
That was so good. I do have a comment.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, I liked how the father was portrayed in this. In some kids' movies, it's really dumbed down. This father was really, he was really good. I think the scene I liked with him the most was when he goes into Riley's room and he's trying to talk to her after he sent her to her room and he's trying to get her to laugh and to talk to him. And when he realized she wasn't responding, he said, okay, you need time alone and I'll be back later. And that was really nice that they didn't paint him as a stupid father, even though they had the bits where he's like distracted.
Well, neither of the parents were stupid. And normally you kind of had people feel like they need to differentiate who's what in the family. And this was a very normal family.
Well,
go ahead.
I like seeing that because, you know, a lot of Disney movies, you don't have both parents.
Exactly.
Actually, most Disney movies, you don't. And it was really nice to see those dynamics of a whole family structure there and how they play out and the differences between them.
Yeah.
Would have been nice to see a sibling, but we can take what we get.
Yeah.
That's all right. I don't mind that. So as far as the character design went, one of the things in this movie that really stuck out to me was the fact that everybody's anger emotion in this movie, every representation of these different characters' anger was short, squarish, and red.
Mm-hmm. Well, they had different colored ones, too.
Yeah, but that was only in the bus driver.
That's true.
only the bus driver had all angers and just different colors. But but the idea that, you know, you could easily tell, you know, the different characters and what they were just by a glance.
Disgust.
No, even disgust, because she's green. You know, like,
you
can tell. Like, all the different characters and how the different colors, you know, interact. Red, anger, you know, and joy is this bright, you know, sunny color, you know, yellow, and sadness is blue. I'm blue, Dabba Diba, Eiffel 65.
Yeah.
The colors is a great thing. You know, you can immediately tell what the characters are like, and it's very, like, cartoon basics. And I felt that was really, really good. Reminded me a little of Sword in the Stone, how you can always tell in the Wizard's Duel that it's Merlin or it's Madam Mim, because of the colors that they choose and because of certain characteristics like the whiskers on Merlin and stuff like that. So, did you guys have anything to say about the character design at all or anything like that? Abigail?
No. Ben? They were great.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how in depth we want to go into this. I don't know if y'all noticed, but it stood out to me that that in Riley's head we had a mix of male and female characters.
Yeah,
that's a good point too.
I
yeah, go ahead.
I have a theory about this that when you reach a certain age, like, the parents, they all, like, the dad's emotions all had mustaches. And the mom's emotions all had, like, her hair and, like, glasses or something like her. So, like, I feel like when Riley would reach a certain age and she gets those characteristics that define her or define her personality.
That's a good point.
She would get those and they would change to, I don't know.
Well, yeah, I mean, my thoughts on it, I mean, I can go really, really.
Go for it, Ben. I don't care.
I mean.
Chris can edit it out if he wants.
The way I want to see this, the way I think it should be seen, is that as they get older, the emotions get more more mature, more leveled out. They learn how to coordinate, work together. They kind of morph into each other, and they fit better. And that's the theory I'm gonna go with.
We kind of see that with the memories. You know, the memories are different colors at the end for Riley.
Yes,
and I thought that was really interesting because, when you're a little kid, your emotions are pretty black and white. You know, they're they're immediately what you're feeling at that moment to
100%. It's full rage or full sadness. You know, there's never not until you're older that you get this bittersweet.
Yes.
Yeah.
I missed that part.
You didn't notice
was
that?
Was it blue and yellow?
They had blue and yellows. They had, like, green and purples. They had, all kinds of different things.
I never saw that.
Green and reds, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
So, I mean, the other theory, and I don't want this to be the case, and, you know, thankfully no one's really trying to go down that road with it, but because it's associated with Disney, there's a possibility that perhaps they're trying to say that she hasn't decided her gender yet.
I know they were gonna.
I don't want to go down that road. I really don't see that being the case.
I
think people could make an argument for that, which really is disgusting.
I saw that suggestion in a YouTube comment somewhere, and that's the only place I've seen it until you brought it up. So good job, Ben.
I'm sorry.
I'm just joking.
I am almost positive Riley wasn't the only one, though. I have to go back and look. That didn't have all one gender in their brain. I seem to remember at least one other. There was somebody.
There was one other person who had a mix as well, but most everyone else was either one or the other.
Right. Which, you know, the other thing that could be said, and you can headcanon this if you need to, is the idea that some people are more well-rounded than others.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's a simple
exactly. Thing. And that's the way I want to go with this. Yeah.
Yes.
But with Disney at this point, you never know what they're trying to get across.
Oh, yeah. But anyway. Mm-hmm. We crossed that with Tomorrowland.
I was not there for that podcast.
That's okay. You saw the movie. I can talk to you about that later. So, Abigail, would you mind talking about this little thing here? We had an experience at the theater, actually going out of the theater. Take a listen to this, Ben.
Well, before that, there was another part where there's a scene where Riley is crying with her parents and telling them that she misses. Minnesota is where they
right,
were from.
Right, it's the ending bit,
and this
yeah.
kid in front of me is going, "Why sad, Mom? Why crying? Why
like
sad?"
Yelling it.
Like, really loud.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm just like, okay, Abigail, I can focus on the story. It's okay. But then when we're leaving the theater, I overhear this mom with a young child on her hip. I think it was a little boy, maybe 2 or 3 or something like that.
Right.
She's talking to another mother, and she's saying, I caught... That was too story-driven for him. And I'm pretty sure she had just gotten out of seeing Inside Out. And that was very sad that her kid couldn't pay attention to the story.
Well,
know he's young, but...
Right. It's not so much that. It's the idea in our culture that kids, by nature, have short attention spans. And you have to
cater to them every minute.
Exactly. You have to cater to them as opposed to training them to appreciate stories.
Exactly. And that's where I love Pixar is that Pixar actually puts a decent story in that, you know, it's more than just entertainment. I mean, it really delved into some dark areas there. I mean, content wise, it should get a G rating, but thematically, I would almost go with a PG or PG-13.
Definitely.
You know?
Well, this is going to be a movie that a lot of kids are going to grow up watching as, you know, a fun, kid-friendly movie with a lot of bright colors and things, and then when they see it later, Oh,
yeah.
You're going to be like, my childhood just taught me something. What is this?
Yeah.
It is a film that has so many layers and levels. And I was just thinking back to, you know, character design. Again, one of the things that's going to go over kids' heads is the one little scene where they went through the thing that made them two-dimensional. Abstract Alley or whatever it was. That was amazing piece of animation.
Yeah,
I loved it so much. They were able to go that crazy in concept and stuff and do something that they would normally do in their shorts, probably.
Yeah.
Yet they did it in a full-length movie and made it fit within the plot. I thought that was particularly impressive.
That was hilarious.
Yeah, they had a lot of cool concepts in this movie. One of my favorites was when they were putting on the dreams or whatever, and they had like a field where it made them look like reality, and like it was so good. And I like seeing Fear riffing on all the dreams.
He was straight MST3K-ing that junk.
He was like, "Oh, she's such a bad actor. Do we really have to watch this?"
Didn't see that coming.
So good.
Yeah. And the dog ripping apart, that was just like, what? Okay then.
Oh, and then for the last 20 minutes, we get like so many tears and feelings. And then after the credits, you get the funny stuff, finally.
Yes. Yeah.
You get to laugh.
Well, we laughed before, but.
I know, but you needed something to lighten the mood.
Guys.
Yeah, it didn't mix quite as well as some of the other Pixar films. It didn't really balance itself out. It was, you know, pretty serious for a good while, and then funny for a good while, and then sad for a good while, and yeah, that's true.
I think it did blend pretty well, because to me, like, you know, Abigail was talking about pacing and all that other kind of stuff. I think the pacing actually works into the theme. The theme that we are dealing with, the emotional instability of an 11-year-old girl who's moved to a new town.
That's true.
I think that really feeds into the pacing, and it needed to be that way. We needed to be jarred at certain moments, and things needed to be weird, and, you know, the train of thought. It's like, you know, yeah, you could get from point A to point B with a whole bunch of different ways and stuff like that. So, you know, why not throw a crazy train in there that runs on, you know, when she's awake, and, you know, throw in all these random plot elements and things, because this is the imagination of a young lady.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's that to me, like the subconscious, you know, factor of it and imagination. That's pretty great. So, guys, I have to ask you this question. Have you ever seen a movie with as much subtle, even like some of it's not subtle, but as much subtle metaphor as this movie has?
Hmm.
This movie has so much metaphor in it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, it just, the story lends itself to it. No. I mean,
I didn't think that you could put this much metaphor in a story. Like, the only story I can think of, because it's virtually all metaphor and allegory, is Pilgrim's Progress.
Yeah, that's what I was just thinking.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only other story I can think of that has as much metaphor and allegory as this film. And to me, it's such a lost art, being subtle with those sorts of things, and making these things, and that this movie was so subtle in so many ways. Like, yeah, it was over the top. Like, their names were Joy, Sadness, etc. But I don't know that it's over the top so much as allegory, you know?
Yeah.
It's an allegorical tale of psychology in a way.
Yeah. Well, this is definitely one of those movies you could go back, watch a second time. It's, you know, it's one of the ones I actually want to watch a second time.
Yes.
Most movies, I don't want to do that, but I could definitely see myself going back, watching this a second time and just getting a whole lot more out of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Any thoughts on that, Sissy?
Oh, it was good. I definitely picked up on a lot of it. One I didn't pick up on, it's kind of a funny thing. My little brother Daniel mentioned to me that it was headquarters.
Yeah.
And then I realized, oh, because it's in her head. I don't know how I missed that, but I was like, oh, my mind has just been blown. I don't know what to do with this information.
Yes.
It's a word within a word. Wordception.
I will say, I do think this is a much more interesting journey into the mind than Inception.
Definitely.
I've never seen Inception.
Let me put it at least this way. Inside Out is a much more accurate representation of my mind than Inception.
3 years of piano lessons. Gone.
Yes.
That was
yes.
That triple man gum.
Triple man gum.
That was so good.
So many good jokes. So good. So, anyway, we're right at around 30 minutes. That's a pretty amazing, and I think we got just about everything out. So I'm going to go ahead and give you guys one last chance to bring up anything you didn't want to bring or you didn't bring up before. I'll go ahead and let Ben do that first while Abigail mulls over because I can see her face.
Thank you.
let me think about this. I mean, I don't know. There's not too much more to go into. I mean, it was a phenomenal film. I really enjoy seeing an animation delve into it. You know, and that's one of those things, I don't think you could do this live action at all. I think it would have to be animation or cartoon. That's like the only way it could be done. Otherwise, you're going to come out with some weird something, you know, that looks like it's from the 80s if you try to do the live action, you know? So, yeah. No, it was phenomenal, and I really look forward to the next Pixar film. I mean, this is, in my mind, this is definitely a comeback.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Don't
yeah.
call it a comeback.
Anyway. All right, fine.
what I was going to say was, I really hope people don't take it too seriously. Like, oh, it's a breakthrough in child psychology, blah, 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 blah. Like, no, this is a cool concept and a really interesting film. And it may be fun to think about, wow, what if it was like this in real life? Would anger be controlling me or fear? Blah, 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 blah.
Well, that was an interesting thing, too, is they didn't focus on the... they really left it kind of ambiguous as to whether or not your emotions control you.
Yeah.
Which mm-hmm. is an interesting concept in and of itself. Some people think that they're like, oh, I was just born this way. This is how I have to do things, you know, whatever. And they immediately go that route. And blame their emotions. And then some people say, emotions have nothing to do with anything ever. Mm-hmm. And I just go, no, that's not true either. And it was very much a middle ground. Mm-hmm. I found interesting, and just the whole entire system that they cooked up in their mind of, you know, you have these different islands, these different, you know, core memories, the things that define you and your personality, mm-hmm. the things that happen to you, almost like scars or wounds that either, are good or bad or whatever. And they define who you are. And everything else branches off of that and creates these islands and things. And just the visual representation and physical representation in the story of doing that on that scale was fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to say something. One thing I just thought about, I was like, there was a lot going on in this movie. I mean, she was mad at her friend and they didn't resolve that. Her dad
That's
was
true.
Working a lot. They didn't resolve that. They
no,
did
but
not...
they resolved that they were going to work together.
Yeah,
so there was,
yeah that's
there
what
was,
I was saying.
There was somewhat of a
that's
resolution.
That's what I was saying. It didn't matter that they didn't resolve the friend storyline. It didn't matter that they didn't completely resolve all the other little side plots. But what did matter was they resolved that.
They emotionally resolved it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that was really important.
Yeah. Good point.
Oh, I do have to say, how do you guys like the bit where the girl, where Riley bumps into the boy and he's like showing his eye where there's like sirens going off?
That was phenomenal.
That was so good. Oh my goodness.
That was hilarious. Yeah. Well, and that's one of the other things. They stereotype a lot of characters, you know, especially with the dad there. He's like, what'd she say? Sorry, Serge. No one was listening. You know, they really stereotyped it, but not too much, not to make it awful. And they really hit some areas. It's like, okay, you know, I remember times in my life being, you know, numb, basically, where I didn't feel any emotion. It's like, you know, I'm sad, but I've been sad so long that I'm not sad anymore. I'm just kind of numb.
Yeah.
No, and they really hit that, and it's like, oh man,
getting on the bus.
Well, also just that point in your life as a kid, I feel like is almost always a turning point.
Yeah.
almost always that time just before puberty when you're realizing you're going to be an adult soon.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, and just the scariness of it, and yeah.
Yeah, and wondering if you are strong enough to do these things, and that mm-hmm. really is like a time where everything gets rewritten, and that's kind of what happened in this movie. You know, her brain is having an emotional breakdown, and all these islands are crashing and stuff in her life. That's such an amazing metaphor. Like, everything you knew is crumbling.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's good that they did it at that age, and they didn't do it at, like, say, like, 15 or so. Like, they could do the same concept with other ages, but I think it worked best at 11 to 12 years old.
Oh, agreed. Well, it wouldn't be as innocent if they did it a little older.
Yes. Yeah, this is true.
That's true. Whoops.
Well, we'll go ahead and wrap this up here, guys. I do have two small announcements for y'all. First of all, on the 26th, we will be having our 50th anniversary episode of Story... Or, yeah, 50th episode.
Anniversary.
Anyway. 50 years, you yes, guys? Yes, 50 years. You guys are old.
We are so old.
How are you alive?
But the 50th episode of Story to Screen, we will be live together, hopefully, at Chris's house, and we will be live on Mixler at, I believe, 7 o'clock. You can check the... I may be wrong on that, but you can check the Story
Details
to Screen
to come.
Facebook page. Well, the event is on the Facebook page, so you can go there and check that out. Also, I'm going to announce that I have a special announcement at the 50th concerning a possible new podcast that I might be heading. So, any which way, let's go ahead and, Abigail, where can people find you?
You can find me at youtube.com/MissHappyNarwhal.
Watch all her awesome ukulele stuff.
Thank you.
Yes. And Ben, where can people find you once again?
You can find me at indyvfx.com. That's INDY and the letters VFX.com. And I just ramble about film-related stuff, gaming. I put up whatever project, CG project I'm working on or whatever. So, yeah, that's it.
Excellent. And as always, you can find me and my stories, all my social medias there too, at rhymeandspace.com. Thank you all very, very much. Don't forget to like the Facebook page for Story to Screen. Subscribe on iTunes if you aren't already. And everyone, have a good night and try not to be too terribly sad after this movie. Or at least crying. So.
All right. Goodbye, everyone.
Well, then we will jump right into our review. Hit the trailer, Chris.
Chris isn't here.
Well, Chris is going to edit.
Oh, okay. Hi, Chris.
We'll just leave that in.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Then we go.
Yeah.
And I moved the microphone a little closer to her. So, anyway, I guess I'll just do the Chris thing here. And I do it just like Chris there. anyway.